Olympic Games is something you really can't put into words. It's way more than the football game. It's a classic matchup. I mean, it's like a Greek contest.
You could throw the record away when that big game rolls around because there's so much sentiment, so much desire.
And as I reached the light of the tunnel, I could see the blue and gold surrounding the red, and it's just a rush that went through you. And from that moment on, I was in love with the big game.
It's not your arm or your leg or your life or your wife or anything like that. It's much more important.
There are a lot of rivalries, but there's nothing to match the big game.
Well, there you have it. Another thrilling, heart-stopping, last-second finish to a classic college football rivalry. The big game, Cal and Stanford. A century-old gridiron tradition between two great universities. But it's more than that. The big game is an event. A celebration, a time each year when the air comes alive with chants of go Stanford and beat Cal, when alumni from both schools come together to witness a new chapter of history in the making. And what a history it's been.
Nearly a dozen years after America's first intercollegiate football game was played between Princeton and Rutgers in 1869, college football moved west and found its home on the Berkeley campus of the University of California in 1881.
With almost a decade of local club play under their belts, the 1891 Football Bears were searching for their first college opponent. Looking across the bay, Cal issued a challenge to newly established Leland Stanford Junior University for a Thanksgiving Day football game. Stanford refused the offer, explaining they had not yet had time to organize a football team to compete against the more seasoned California Bears. But 6 months later, Stanford was ready. And the greatest rivalry in college football history was about to begin.
The pent-up enthusiasm burst with a bang in San Francisco the day of the game. All morning, the students paraded the streets, tooting horns and giving yells. For hours before the game, there was a steady procession to the grounds. Cable cars, bicycles, gaily decorated coaches, all sorts of vehicles were pressed into service.
Those were the words of Clinton R. Brickmorse, one of the Cal players on that first big game team, who later became a well-known San Francisco sports writer and big game historian. That first game was played March 19, 1892, on the field at Haight and Stanion Streets in San Francisco. Unbeknownst to Brick or any of the other 15,000 plus in attendance, a tradition was about to be born, one that would last not just years or even decades, but for a century and beyond.
At last, the hour of the contest arrived. 15,000 people, a record-breaking crowd, were present when the two teams trotted onto the field. The referee drew his whistle and asked for the football to be put in position for the kickoff. Lo and behold, each team had forgotten to bring that all-essential article, the football.
Some say Stanford team manager and future president Herbert Hoover was at fault. Others point toward California. But nonetheless, the first big game could not yet begin. As luck would have it, a local sporting goods store owner was in attendance, and he volunteered to ride his horse downtown and bring back a football. He returned an hour later with what was described as a pudgy cross between a punching bag and a football. Finally, the coin was tossed, and the big game became a part of history. The larger and more experienced California team was heavily favored going into the inaugural game. But like so many Cal-Stanford games since, the pregame predictions turned out to have nothing to do with the final outcome as Stanford defeated the Bears by a score of 14-10, thereby giving the fans the first of many big game upsets to come. A second big game was played in 1892, this time in the fall, where it would stay for the next 100 years. And again, Stanford prevailed. It wasn't until 1898, 6 years, three ties, and seven games later that the Bears were able to finally post their first big game win.
California repeated its success over the cards of that era, but not before the big game's greatest tradition was established, that of the Stanford Axe.
The Axe is a great symbol of the California-Stanford rivalry. Actually, the axe was originated at Stanford. They fashioned it for a baseball game in about the year 1899, I think it was. And that became one of their trophies.
Stanford and Cal at that time had been rivals for seven years. We had a baseball game in the spring, and our mascot went down to the hardware store and purchased an axe, a planer's axe, to use to chop up. The reports vary at this point whether it was an effigy of a bear, the symbol of the University of California, or whether it was some ribbons of blue and gold. But it was intended to do some damage to a symbol of Cal, and the Cal fans at the game got very upset. They stole it from him. They mobbed him after the game, stole the axe, and there was a long chase through the streets of San Francisco. And eventually, at the end of the day, the axe made it over to Berkeley. Is safe in the hands of the Berkeley students, and they proceeded to put it in a bank vault where they left it for 30 or so years, only bringing it out on the occasion of the baseball game between Stanford and Cal.
An uncle of mine whose name was Jack Eppinger, who was a Berkeley student at the turn of the century, was about 5'2" or 5'3". He did tell me, as a matter of fact, that he was the one they dressed up as a girl when they stole the axe and they had to cut off the handle. That's one reason that you see the axe now without a long handle. And he put it under the skirt that they had him in, and he's the one who took it back to Berkeley.
I go back to a day in 1930. I believe it was after the big game that year, when the California committee was taking the axe back to the bank vault to protect it. And Stanford apparently had a determination to recover the axe, and they had a committee, 15 or so people, and they dressed themselves up as photographers, and they all had flash bulbs and cameras, and it looked like they were the genuine thing.
Some Stanford students, which we delightfully call the Immortal 21, had planned to get the axe back. For 4 years at Stanford, they planned, and finally came the day, their senior year, that that they were finally able to get the opportunity, and they said, "We'd like to take a picture for the paper." They had dressed up as reporters at this rally, and they said, "Could the crowd clear away? We'd like to take a picture for the paper," and they set off smoke grenades and some other devices to scatter the crowd. A couple of their members grabbed the axe, then what ensued is, again, not clear, but somehow the axe reappeared on the other side of the bay down at Stanford.
Subsequently, the two schools agreed that they would make the axe a symbol of the big game, and it would go to the winner of the big game, and they would keep it until the next big game, and if the other team won, they would turn over the game. And they did that always in the ceremony after the big game.
In 1904, 14 years after its inception, the big game left San Francisco and moved on campus, first to Berkeley and the following year to Stanford. Going into the 1905 game, Stanford held a slight edge in the series with 6 wins, 4 losses, and 4 ties. But that year, Cal was favored to close the gap. Unbeknownst to players and fans alike, this would be the last football big game played between the two schools for the next 14 years. Stanford upset the favored Bears by a score of 12-5, but the card celebration was short-lived. Soon after the game, their president, David Starr Jordan, and Cal's Benjamin Ide Wheeler decreed an end to American football for the two schools. Each had become concerned over the injuries and violence that resulted from the game. Their solution? Ban the sport from both campuses. But the spirit and tradition of the big game continued on. For the next 9 years, rugby replaced football as the annual contest between Cal and Stanford. During that era, the Cards held a 5-win, 3-loss, 1-tie edge over the Bears. In 1915, football returned to the University of California campus, and 1 year later, with the arrival of Andrew Latham Smith, Cal football was clearly on the rise. Meanwhile, Stanford continued playing rugby rather than football through the 1918 season. It would be 1919 before the two schools would resume their football rivalry. For the next 5 years, the Cal Wonder Team would dominate the big game. 1922 brought the Cards a permanent home for their football program down on the farm. In the first big game played in Stanford Stadium, Andy Smith's Bears defeated the Cards 28-0. After the 1923 Cal win, 3 decades of big game football had been played, and for the first time, the series was deadlocked at 12 wins each with 5 ties. With the success of Cal's Andy Smith and his national championship Wonder Team, Stanford soon countered by bringing in the legendary Glenn Pop Warner to head up the Cards football program. Warner assistants Andy Kerr and Tiny Thornhill had preceded Pop to Palo Alto by 2 years. But in 1924, Pop Warner himself took over control of Stanford's gridiron fortunes. Going into the 24 contest, California had won 5 straight big games and were slightly favored to win their 6th. But Pop Warner's undefeated Cards, led by All-American Ernie Nevers, were ready to take on the Bears. The winner of the 1924 big game would earn a trip to the Rose Bowl. Stanford was 7-0 going into the big game against the 7-0-1 Bears. Because of what was considered a tougher schedule, the odds makers picked Cal to win both the big game and another conference championship. But that's not the way Stanford saw the outcome. A seesaw battle had the favored Bears in the lead late in the 4th quarter, but a Stanford score and successful conversion gave the Cards the so-called victory with a 20-20 tie. Pop had his first trip to Pasadena. The following year, Ernie Nevers scored 2 big-game touchdowns to lead Stanford to a 27-14 victory over the Bears. It was the Cards' first big-game win since the 1919 resumption of the Cal-Stanford rivalry. After the sudden death of Cal coach Andy Smith in 1926, Pop Warner's Cards continued their big-game domination over California. The powerful Stanford team won 4 of the next 5 games with 1 tie. They piled up 129 points to Cal's 31. Players like All-American Ted Shipke, Tricky Dick Hyland, and George Bogue played key roles in Stanford's offensive show during those glorious years. After the 1932-0-0 tie in the big game, Pop Warner shocked Stanford players and fans alike when he left the farm to return to the East. Years later, he would tell friends it was the worst mistake he'd ever made. An era had ended. Pop's 5-1-3 big game record against Cal would stand as a benchmark for all those who would follow him. But as one chapter in Stanford football history came to a close, a new one was about to begin. You see, a group of guys called the Vow Boys had arrived on the Stanford campus. In 1933, more than just pride was at stake for the Vow Boys in their first big game. The legendary Stanford Axe had resurfaced after a 30-year hibernation on the Berkeley campus. And for the first time, it was declared the official trophy of a big game victory. But the Axe wasn't the only reward to be gained from a win. An invitation to Pasadena awaited the winner of the 1933 big game. The legendary Stanford Vow Boy team, featuring the likes of All-Americans Bones Hamilton, Bobby Grayson, Bob Horse Reynolds, and Monk Moskrip, was only 10-7 favorites going into the 1933 contest. And it turned out to be for a good reason. Defense dominated as Cal took an early 3-0 lead that lasted well into the 4th quarter. Stanford finally scored on a thrilling 57-yard touchdown bomb, making the score 7-3. On 4th and goal, an interception by Stanford's Bones Hamilton ended California's hopes for a big game victory and gave the Indians a New Year's trip to Pasadena.
They were a team that had great respect for each other and understood that it was team play that would win a game. And they loved to win. And they loved to play, and they loved to have fun. And fortunately, our coach, Tiny Thornhill, allowed us to be the laughing boys at Stanford. And we just loved to get after those Bears, and vice versa. And I don't know any group who play harder, cleaner, historically, And, you know, some of our greatest friends are California people.
The Val boys continued their win streak over both conference opponents and arch-rival California in both 1934 and 35. But the big game was never an easy win for the awesome Stanford team. Highlighted by a double reverse touchdown run by Bones Hamilton, Stanford edged the stubborn Bears 9-7 in the 34 contest. In the 1935 big game, Coach Tiny Thornhill's Val boy team had earned a 6-1 season record against an undefeated Cal team. Ranked fifth in the nation, the Bears knew that the winner of the 41st big game would not only bring home the axe, but also earn a Rose Bowl trip to Pasadena. With that as an incentive, the Indians rose to the occasion, beating the favored Bears by a score of 13-0. With the arrival of Cal's Thunder team on the turf of Memorial Stadium, there were few bright spots for the Indians during the next four big games. The names of Vic Batari, Johnny Meek, and Sam Chapman would haunt Stanford fans until 1940. As the roar of Cal's Thunder team faded away from Berkeley, it was replaced by a new rumbling in Palo Alto. Cheers of wow could be heard echoing through Stanford Stadium in 1940. Clark Shaughnessy and his revolutionary T formation had come to the farm. Led by All-American Frankie Albert and star running back Pete Kometovic, it was the Wow Boys' turn to dominate college football. Undefeated going into the big game, Stanford's Wow Boys found themselves facing a surprisingly tough Cal team. But the magic of quarterback Frankie Albert, running back Pete Kometovic, and All-American lineman Chuck Taylor proved to be too much as Cal lost the axe to the talented red and white 13-7.
We had been a single-wing team the year previous when we didn't win a game. We turned around with a T formation and a new coach and a new attitude, and we didn't lose a game. And the opposition, our opponents, had never seen the T formation before, and it was so much fun to get the ball from center and make a couple fakes to the backs going into the line and then drop back to pass, and nobody could find the ball. And it was really a fun formation for us because we were so successful.
Well, we, of course, we knew about, they had played the whole season with a T formation, and we had never played against it, but we played a very good game against them. In fact, we almost won the game.
Coming off a perfect 10-0 season and a national ranking, the Wow Boys continued their winning ways going into the big game. Cal was a 12-point underdog to the powerful Indians. But from the opening kickoff, the inspired Bears made it clear that this year the axe belonged to them.
Cal won. They blocked two of my punts, and it was rather embarrassing in front of 80,000 people to have two punts blocked when you hadn't had one blocked all in 3 years.
But those results were very quickly forgotten as 8 days later, on December 7th, 1941, the Japanese attacked Pearl Harbor and the war to end all wars had begun. With the resumption of the big game rivalry in 1946, the Indians added another victory to the win column, extending their series lead to 23 games over Cal's 18, and there had been 8 ties. But little did Stanford fans know how long they would have to savor that 1946 big game win. With the arrival of Pappy Waldorf at the University of California, it would be 8 long years before the Indians would bring the axe back to Palo Alto. But in typical big game fashion, the games were seldom dull.
We had lost one game all year and were ranked number 3 in the nation. We went down to play Stanford on the farm. They hadn't won a game. They hadn't tied a game.
An 8-1 Cal record against winless Stanford made the Bears 28-point favorites prior to the 1947 game, the longest odds in big game history.
This was something really quite special. So you knew from the beginning you were going to be in for
a very exciting afternoon. The excitement wasn't quite what we had planned for, and I must say I'm just grateful we were able to pull it out.
A hard-fought first half had the stunned Cal Bears leading by a score of only 14-6. As the second half opened, Stanford narrowed the lead to 14-12. It didn't look promising for the Golden Bears. Early in the fourth quarter, the unbelievable happened. Stanford went ahead 18-14. With less than 3 minutes remaining, Indian fans were dancing in the aisles of Stanford Stadium.
We were on our own 20-yard line, and Keckley, who hadn't played for the last four or five games of the season with a shoulder injury, came into the game. He prevailed upon Pappy to let me finish up the Stanford game. You know, I haven't gotten to play most of the season. He came into the game, and Dick Erickson called the Gantenbein pass. Well, the play starts with a pitch out to the fullback, who was Jack Jensen. He swept to the right, stopped, and threw back to the left where Keckley was waiting for the ball on the flat. It was a lousy pass. It fluttered and blustered, but it got there.
Cal fans went wild while Stanford rooters sat in shocked silence. The big game had lived up to its name once again. The 1953 big game is considered by many to be one of the most exciting of all time. It featured the offensive brilliance of two All-American quarterbacks, Paul Larson of California and Stanford's Bobby Garrett. Neither of them failed to live up to their advanced billings. Stanford was installed as a 7-point favorite, but most of the experts were calling it a toss-up, and for good reason.
Watch the next play coming up now as the Bears have the ball. First and 10 on the Stanford 8. White is out as a flanker to the left. Larson takes the ball this time, rolls out to his left, hands the ball to White. White gets away from the Stanford tackler, crosses the 10, the 5, and drives into the end zone for a California score. Third down and 9 now for the Indians on the California 19-yard line as they come driving right back to get points on the scoreboard. Garrett again drops back. He looks for his receiver, and this time it's Sam Worley. And Worley makes a great catch, and it's good for 14 yards and a first down. Larson takes the ball from center. He drops back, looks down the field for a receiver. He gets the pass away, but it's intercepted by Bobby Garrett of Stanford. Garrett is across the midfield stripe, the California 40, gets good blocking, goes to the sidelines, across the Cal 20, the 15, the 10, into the corner and into the end zone for a Stanford touchdown.
The score was tied at 21 apiece midway through the fourth quarter, but this one was far from over. A 15-yard penalty against the Indians gave Cal possession on the Stanford 8-yard line with only enough time on the clock for one play.
The ball is snapped. It's placed down. The kick is in the air. But the field goal attempt is not good. And a few moments later, the game ended with our final scoreboard reading Stanford 21, California 21. In a game that wasn't decided until the final gun, Coach Waldorf's Bears and Coach Chuck Taylor's Indians battled to a 21-21 tie.
1955 would end Stanford's 9-year big game drought. Led by All-American John Brodie and Paul Wigan, the Indians overwhelmed the Bears 19-0. Brodie passed for over 250 yards and his running backs added another 200 as Stanford completely dominated the overmatched Bears. Going into the 1956 big game, Stanford was a 2-touchdown favorite over the hapless Bears, who had only earned a 2-7 season record. But the odds makers hadn't counted on Pappy Waldorf's surprise resignation only 4 days before the game.
I'll never forget the Thursday that Pappy Waldorf called us in and basically went on to say that he was going to retire after this big game 2 days from now. And immediately, we didn't want to let him down. As a football team, we just decided that we had to win that football game.
Cal played like a team possessed. This one was for Pappy. John Brodie's brilliant passing made the game close, but in the end, Cal took the axe back to Berkeley.
And there's the final gun, California 20, Stanford 18.
He announced his retirement just before the big game, which irritated me a little bit because I knew he was going to get some mileage out of that. So the following year, I decided to do the same thing. So I'll hopefully get some mileage out of it as far as the players are concerned.
1957 was Stanford's year to pay tribute to their departing coach. In Chuck Taylor's last game before he moved upstairs, an inspired Stanford team led by quarterback Jackie Douglas and running back Lou Valley gave the Indians a tough 14-12 big game victory. The 1959 big game again pitted the top passing receiving combination in the country, Dick Norman to Chris Burford, against a Cal team that had only completed 29 passes all season. But typical of so many big games in the past, the fans quickly learned to expect the unexpected. After a scoreless first quarter, Cal jumped to a 14-0 halftime lead. And to the amazement of Stanford and Cal fans alike, it was through the air. But this big game was far from over. Dick Norman had just started his record-setting performance.
We had a quarterback, Dick Norman, who led the nation in total offense and in passing. He was 34 for 39, which was then the collegiate record at the time in one game. He threw up over 400 yards. I caught 12 passes. I really caught 14, and two were called back. Dick was throwing the ball so well, he had a couple taken away.
With just minutes left in the game, Norman went to work again. He moved the Indians to the Golden Bears 9-yard line with only 20 seconds left on the clock.
At the end of the game, it was 20-17 with just a couple of moments remaining. Dick Norman goes out of bounds to stop the clock down around the 4-yard line. Once again, we're not going to take the field goal, but the time runs out. We don't score. We lose 20-17. Fabulous game. All kind of interesting things happen, but as I mentioned earlier, a little bit of a heartbreak loss for Stanford.
With nothing at stake other than pride in the axe, a winless Stanford team wasn't able to stop a solid California ground game. As Cal went on to defeat the Indians 21-10 in the 1960 big game, running back Skip Face was the star of Stanford's valiant but losing effort. But Stanford could take heart. Beginning in 1961, the Indians were about to set a big game record for most consecutive wins that would last 6 long years. Coming off 2 straight big game victories over California, things were starting to look up for the Stanford football program even prior to the 1963 season. And the appointment of John Ralston as the Indians' new head coach would go a long way toward continuing that trend. A former Cal player and former assistant to Pappy Waldorf, John built an impressive 7-2 record against his alma mater. 1963 also brought a sobering note to the big game festivities. On November 22nd, one day before the traditional Cal-Stanford rivalry was to be played, President John F. Kennedy was assassinated in Dallas, Texas. For the first time in history, stunned university officials postponed the big game a week until November 30th in honor of our country's fallen leader.
I can remember we were going to get him because we wanted to beat Stanford and John, here's John the turncoat going from Cal to Stanford, and we were going to get him, and Steve Thurlow, Stanford's great back, was hurt, and they called the game off for a week. And of course, Thurlow came back. Stanford wins the game, and everyone feels bad. I was mad at John for at least 2 or 3 weeks. Then, ironically, he hired me to come to Stanford with him. And it was, as I said, a great experience. Two Rose Bowls, taking a Stanford program that had floundered a little bit prior to that time. And John, with his tremendous enthusiasm and motivation, took that team and developed it over an 8-9 year period to two successive Rose Bowls and two Rose Bowl victories. To me, one of the great accomplishments in sports.
That was kind of fun to be over on the other side of the fence as the football coach and coming out of that tunnel, bringing a team onto the surface of Memorial Stadium. I thought that probably was the greatest sports thrill I ever had. And then, of course, to have your team end up successfully in the game, it was a lot of fun.
The Plunkett to Gene Washington connection led the conference in passing and receiving heading into the 71st big game against Cal's nationally ranked defense. But the potent Stanford passing game was more than the favored Bears could handle.
One particular play that I remember most about that game is we were down about the 20-yard line, and Jim called this reverse play for me. And as soon as the ball was handed off to me, I could see the goal line. And it was one of those strange things. It's almost like time stood still. The only thing I remember is that I dove from about 4 yards out. Fortunately, I ended up in the end zone, and we scored a touchdown. And we beat a very, very good Cal football game, a football team that day. And I had a good game and ended up with a record-setting year as a receiver, thanks in great deal to the throwing arm of Jim Plunkett.
Gene Washington was an exceptional athlete here at Stanford. He made an immediate impact on I think, the course that Stanford took after that year, 1968. We started to throw the ball much more. We went deep. He made the game exciting, you know, game after game.
1969 looked like it would be a repeat of the previous year's big game. To no one's surprise, the highly favored Indians immediately took control of the game. After a quick 47-yard scoring pass to Howie Williams, Plunkett found Jack Lassiter for a second Stanford TD. This one covering 72 yards. After falling behind by 17 points, the Bears finally came out of hibernation and began one of the most amazing comebacks in big game history. In the second half, an inspired Cal team led by quarterback Dave Penhall put the Bears on top of the stunned Indians 28-23.
In 1969, when Cal went ahead of us late in the fourth quarter, the thing that I remember most was, you know, I still felt we were going to win the ball game. They just gave us too much time. And that too much time was only a couple of minutes, but that's all I felt we needed.
Undaunted, Stanford came right back down the field, this time primarily on the ground. The two-point conversion try failed, and the score remained Stanford 29, Cal 28, and that's the way it ended.
Another big game, another classic gridiron matchup. But as exciting and unpredictable as each game might be, this storybook rivalry has become much more than just another Saturday afternoon athletic contest. Through the years, the big game has taken on a life of its own. It's become a happening, a week-long celebration steeped in the traditions that have grown and prospered over the decades. From generation to generation, the legacy of the big game spirit lives on in the hearts and minds of those who have been fortunate enough to have been a part of this fabled event.
It's something unique. It's a tradition. It's a long-standing tradition. But it's really a very wholesome and wonderful tradition, too. I hope it never stops.
And in many ways, for many years, big game is one of the basic holidays of the year, if not the basic one.
When big game week comes along, that entire week is just one that is a lot of fun, but also there's a lot of serious ribbing that goes on. There's a lot of pride at stake.
I'll never forget the big game rallies at both Stanford and Cal. The great rallies that Stanford has out in Lake Lagunita when the lake is dry, and they build that big bonfire. And then, of course, at Cal, there's the old Greek Theater. And we have our big game rallies in the Greek Theater.
When I was here at Stanford, and I was a member of the band, the big game was the culmination of the year. So it was a great time. And of course, the Cal band, or the Cal Weenies, as we would call them, they were a lot of fun to compete with. We were crazy running all around the field, and they were always trying to do their precision marching. And we never felt they were too successful at it.
Wonderful day and a wonderful week in the city with all the things that go on between Cal and Stanford, alumni as well as students. Parties of all kinds, tailgates, an opportunity to see some wonderful people, both surprisingly California's as well as our own Stanford people.
I truly love Stanford people. I think they have a great purpose in life to exist so that the Bears can beat them in an athletic contest.
Well, I remember the big game when we were dollies, especially because the rally the night before the game, we went to San Francisco, and I remember doing the can-can on top of the bar at the top of the mark. What an exciting place, and to be doing the can-can on top of that bar for this great, great celebration.
I can't imagine Stanford and Cal without the big game.
1971 would be John Ralston's last big game at Stanford. Don Bunce had admirably replaced Heisman Trophy winner Jim Plunkett at quarterback. Going into the big game, he was ranked third in the nation in total offense. And of course, the Thunder Chickens led a tough Indian defense that allowed the Bears to cross into Stanford territory only three times all afternoon.
When you speak of the Thunder Chickens, the first name that comes up is Pete Lazatich and Dave Tipton, who is now a coach here down on the farm. And the Thunder Chickens are something, is a group, it's a name that's going to go down in the archives, and they are part of the history down here at the farm. A great group of individuals, a great group of guys off the field, and really a great group of individuals to play with and to know.
I don't think that there has ever been a better football staff put together than the staff that John Ralston put together here at Stanford. Now that's saying something, because John Ralston also was over at Cal. And I think the proof is in the pudding. John Ralston took Stanford to two Rose Bowls, and they upset the favorite teams. In addition to being a personal favorite of mine, I just think he's one of the greatest coaches that the collegiate game has ever seen.
Prior to the 1972 season, former Cal player and coach and Stanford assistant Mike White was named to lead the Golden Bears. In his first big game as head coach, the energetic White would face newly appointed Jack Christensen and his renamed Stanford Cardinal team. A week's worth of heavy rain left Memorial Stadium a sea of mud. But any fan who stayed away because of the weather missed another one of the most amazing big games of all time. Because of the playing conditions, fumbles and interceptions were the rule of the day. After the first Cal turnover, Stanford got on the scoreboard with a 24-yard touchdown pass from quarterback Mike Barilla to Eric Cross. Then the miscues took over, with Stanford coming out ahead after Gordon Riegel intercepted a Vince Ferragamo pass and raced 71 yards for a Cardinal score as time ran out in the half. Stanford went into the locker room with a 14-3 advantage. Early in the fourth quarter, the Bears went out in front 18-14. But Barilla and company weren't through yet. A well-balanced drive featuring key passes to Cross and Don Alvarado put the Cardinal back on top 21-18 with only 3 minutes left to play. An opportune Stanford interception seemed to end all hope for the Bears, but Cal's defense held, and they got the ball back with 1:13 remaining in the game. With only 3 seconds left on the clock, it was all or nothing for the Golden Bears as Ferragamo lofted a pass toward the corner of the end zone. a stumbling Sweeney made a desperate dive for the ball as time ran out. Stanford fans stood in shock silence.
Going into the 77th renewal of this annual Fall Classic, the big game series record was only separated by four games. After more upsets, thrilling plays, and great moments than anyone could have ever dreamed of, Stanford held the advantage 35 wins to Cal's 31, and there had been 10 ties. But as the old saying goes, you ain't seen nothing yet, and 1974 would only be the beginning.
Going into the 1974 big game, Coach Mike White's Bears had put together one of the most feared offenses in all of college football. The 19th-ranked Bears' 7-2-1 season record gave them a slight edge over Stanford heading into the annual classic. The explosive Cal offensive duo of Steve Bartkowski to Steve Rivera seemed to set the tone of the game as the Bears quickly moved 81 yards for a score on their first possession. With the score 10-3, Cal seemed to be in control of the 77th big game. Then something happened. It started with an unexpected fake punt that put Stanford in a position for another Langford field goal. Moments later, the Cardinal capitalized on Cal's bad snap from center and went ahead by a score of 13-10. Right when Cal seemed to regain control of the game, another turnover gave the momentum back to the Cardinal. Almost before the jubilant Cardinal fans could recover, Stanford's replacement quarterback, Guy Benjamin, hit Tony Hill for a 61-yard touchdown and a 19-10 big game lead. With 2:27 showing on the clock, Cal scored again, and the Bears were back on top, this time for good. Or so they thought.
Stanford had no timeouts remaining, as I recall, and Benjamin threw two complete passes, receivers going out of bounds, and they stopped the clock with 2 seconds left and Stanford at Cal's 33-yard line.
Our quarterback, Guy Benjamin, later a consensus All-American for Stanford, threw a couple passes to the tight ends, one of which I was involved in, and I came to the sidelines and after the first pass, and Jerry Wallvogel, who was the backup quarterback, called the last three plays because the headphones had been turned off and the coaches from the press box were coming down.
They brought out Mike Lansford to kick what had to be a 50-yard field goal, and of course the Cal kids thought the game was over and there was no way this Mike was going to kick that field goal. But as history records, he did. 50-yard field goal won it for Stanford, and I can still see then the Stanford fans rushing out of their seats, running down the field, and all the Cal rooters started going back up into the stands to get out of their way. It was quite a scene, and that to me was actually the most exciting big game that I broadcast.
Stanford fans could finally forget about 1972 as they carried the axe back home again to Palo Alto. With the unexpected dismissal of Stanford coach Jack Christensen just before the 1976 big game, the Cardinal players were now primed for an upset win over rival California. And win they did, but in typical big game style.
I'll never forget the year that Jack Christensen, the coach at Stanford, was carried on the field before the game, and you knew that I felt that it was going to be a long day and that we weren't going to win that one.
The emotionally charged Cardinal team surged out to a 9-0 advantage under the leadership of signal caller Guy Benjamin. After quarterback Joe Roth and his Golden Bears recovered, it became another back-and-forth big game battle. With 5 minutes left to play, Cal scored another touchdown to go on top 24-19. Time was running out for the Stanford Cardinal. Cal had possession of the ball deep in their own territory. The clock was in their favor. But then disaster struck the Bears. A fumbled Cal pitch was recovered by Stanford's Duncan McCall on the Bears' 2.
Duncan recovered a fumble. I think Stanford then went in and won the game, and Jack Christensen was carried off the field in a tremendous show of emotion for a coach who really had his last hurrah at Stanford.
With the arrival of Bill Walsh on the Stanford campus in 1977, Stanford's big game hopes continued to brighten. The strong Cardinal offense featured such great stars as Darren Nelson, Guy Benjamin, and James Lofton.
Going into the 1977 big game, Cal Berkeley had not been scored on in the first quarter all season. They were extremely proud of that. They had a wonderful defense, had an excellent record, had almost shut out USC. They kicked off to us. We drove 90 yards for a touchdown in 10 plays and broke all of those mores they had developed. And so right away, they were shattered. They had real problems from then on, and we went on to win and beat them soundly.
Walsh would lead his Stanford Cardinal to two convincing big game victories over California. 1978 proved to be another brilliant Stanford offensive show. Quarterback Steve Dills and Ken Marjoram combined with Darren Nelson to dominate the Golden Bears 30-10. As the oddsmakers predicted, the 1981 big game belonged to the Stanford Cardinal. The Elway-White-Tolliver combination gave the 87,000 fans who packed Stanford Stadium quite a show as they defeated the Bears by a score of 28-14 to bring the Axe back to Palo Alto.
After 90 years and 84 big games, only 6 wins separated the two teams. The series stood at 40 wins for Stanford, 34 for the Bears, and there had been 10 ties. But that gap would be narrowed in 1982 with what many say is the most incredible, or controversial, moment in college football history. Quite simply, they called it the play.
The favored Cardinals' powerful offense was highlighted by senior All-American quarterback John Elway. They were opposed by Cal's sophomore sensation, Gale Gilbert. The 80,000-plus fans packing Memorial Stadium anticipated quite a show, and that's exactly what they got. After a scoreless first half, Stanford's heralded offense came to life. With the score 14-13 Stanford, the Bears reclaimed the lead 19-14 on a picture-perfect scoring pass from Gilbert to Wesley Howell. Stanford took possession, trailing by 2 points, with only 1:22 left on the clock. With the ball on their own 20, Elway reached deep into that bag of tricks, engineering an almost miraculous drive. With 8 seconds left, and the ball resting on Cal's 18-yard line, Mark Harmon kicked what every one of the 82,000 fans thought was the winning field goal. Stanford fans already were starting their post-game celebration. With only 4 seconds left, there seemed to be little, if any, hope for the Bears. Then it happened.
Harmon will probably try to squib it, and he does. Ball comes loose, and the Bears have to get out of bounds. Rodgers along the sideline, another one. They're still in deep trouble at midfield. They tried to do a couple of... The ball is still loose as they get it to Rodgers. They give it back now to the 30. They're down to the 20. All the band is out on the field. He's going to go into the end zone. He's got it to the other Bears. The Bears have won. The Bears have won.
When Cal won in the last play of the game, which was a fluke, you really don't need coaches when a team can innovate like that.
A game that was not my favorite big game, but certainly a memorable one, which is where the Cal won on the last play running through the band, and I was there at Berkeley. Fortunately, I can say I wasn't part of the band at the time. Although they got a bum rap, they certainly weren't the only ones on the field at the time. I think half the Stanford players and half the Cal players were on the field.
The 1984 big game was expected to be offense against offense. Stanford's duo of John Pay and Brad Muster against Cal's preseason All-American candidate, Gale Gilbert. The experts turned out to be half right. After 10 unanswered Cal points, Stanford sophomore running back Brad Muster took over the game. His 23-yard run sparked Stanford's first touchdown drive, with John Pay hitting Emil Harry in the end zone for the score. From there, it was Muster, Muster, and more Muster. His 34 big game carries tied the great Ernie Nevers' 1925 Stanford school record. With 204 yards on the ground, he almost single-handedly carried the axe back to Palo Alto himself with a 27-10 Stanford win. As 1985 rolled around, both Stanford and Cal's fans were wondering what would happen next in this year's big game. They were sure they had seen it all. Or had they? Featuring the running of Brad Muster and the passing of John Pay, Stanford dominated the listless Bears, posting an early 24-0 lead. Then, like so many big games before, Cal's replacement quarterback Brian Bedford combined with starter Kevin Brown to set the Bears on fire. It looked like another heart-stopping big game comeback was about to happen. After Cal's surprisingly strong defense added a two-point safety, the Bear offense closed the gap to 24-22 with only 1:40 left in the third quarter. A hard-fought but scoreless fourth quarter gave the Cardinal a well-earned big-game victory. Redshirt freshman quarterback Brian Johnson combined with senior All-American Brad Muster to lead the Stanford Cardinal to an impressive 1987 big-game win over California, 31-7. The Cardinals scored early on an 82-yard touchdown toss from Johnson to Walter Batson, setting a new big-game record, surpassing the 1947 Jackie Jensen to Paul Keckley 80-yard scoring pass. Cal briefly evened the score at 7 apiece, but Stanford then added 24 more unanswered points, using both the pass and the run to overwhelm a frustrated California team. The scoring was capped off with a John Volpe touchdown. Once more, the axe belonged to Stanford. The favored California Bears were optimistic going into the 91st renewal of this college football classic. But nobody had bothered to tell the Stanford team, led by quarterback Jason Palumbas and fullback John Volpe. With the longest kickoff return in big game history, 95 yards by Kevin Scott, Stanford took a 19-12 big game lead going into the fourth quarter. Under the cool leadership of Taylor, the Golden Bears came back to tie the game at 19 apiece. Gaining possession of the ball with only 3.5 minutes left in the game, Troy Taylor once again moved California down the field, sure that Robbie Keane's golden toe would give them another big game victory. Cal's All-American kicker Robbie Keane set up for the chip shot, the snap, the kick. Stanford defensive back Twan Van Lee reached high into the air to block the kick and give the Cardinal an upset 19-19 tie. This time the fates were smiling on the underdog Cardinal. Under coach Denny Green, Stanford entered the 1989 big game with freshman quarterback Steve Smith at the helm, facing Cal senior Troy Taylor. Early on, it appeared Cal's experienced offense might take control of the game, but a surprisingly strong Stanford ground game led by Tommy Vardell and J.J. Lassley outrushed the Bears 254 yards to 65 to power the Cardinal to a 24-14 big game win. The 1990 big game was predicted to be Cal's Russell White versus Stanford's Glenn Milburn. And that's exactly what it turned out to be. While the Bears' talented sophomore ran for 177 yards, Milburn just baffled the Cal defense with 196 yards on the ground, along with 379 all-purpose yards.
The 1990 game was such a memorable one for a lot of reasons. For one thing, you know, you had two great running backs, Russell White and Glenn Milburn, on the field at the same time, and I don't know that that's ever happened, certainly not in my memory, in the big game.
Two teams that were very evenly matched, and a game that had some seesaw effects. Came down to a couple plays. Our team was extremely excited. Cal was extremely excited. I think it was one that some people have said maybe was the best big game ever played. I don't think it was necessarily the two best teams that ever played, obviously, but in some ways, in regards to the dramatics of the game and the twist and the peaks and valleys of both teams emotionally, it might have been one of the best.
With only 12 seconds left, a Stanford score narrowed the Cal margin to 1 point, 25-24. A two-point conversion attempt failed as Cal defensive back John Hardy intercepted Columbus. The Cal fans went crazy. But they had forgotten there were still 12 seconds on the clock. After a successful onside kick, the Cardinal was 32 yards away from the goal line and poised for yet another classic big game finish. Stanford kicker John Hopkins confidently walked on the field and kicked a 39-yard field goal to give the Cardinal an incredible 27-25 big game victory.
When you think about big game finishes, there have been so many that have been spectacular. But I think I would be hard-pressed to find a better ending than the big game last year in Berkeley. Of course, I'm smiling about that one.
Jubilant Stanford fans knew that once and for all, they had finally gotten their revenge, at least for the time being. But for both teams, there is always next year. Because if there's one thing we know about the big game, it is that there will always be next year.
From the very beginning of this classic rivalry, the big game has seldom failed to live up to its name. It's lasted almost a century, not only because it's a time-honored gridiron tradition, but most importantly, because the big game is what college football is really all about. The competition, the spirit, the memories, the traditions, those are the things that have made the big game truly the big game.